lecture. It's a pleasure and an honor to have our guest today, Dr. Thant. He is Vice President for the World Economic Forum's Global Agenda Council for Southeast Asia and advisor for the Myanmar Peace Center. His lecture today is about a very sensitive topic, very important topic for the, especially for the geographical area where his credit exists. From dictatorship to democracy, it's nowadays, it's a very important process that is taking place, and understanding it in a global perspective is very interesting contribution that's been giving us today. Public lectures are a very good occasion for our students to be exposed to the insights and the understanding of global events by people involved directly in those events and guiding them as well. Key personnel and key institutional figures that bring their expertise to complement what we teach to our students in class with our faculty. Public lectures were established 1.5 years ago now. It's the fifth edition today. The public, meaning that they're open to the wide public, most of the guests today, the attendees and students, but we open them up to the public and to the citizens and people widely to emphasize on the interaction of our programs and education and training and research, and generally speaking, and scientific interests to the public in general. I'm leaving the floor to thanking Professor Gregori, the Pro-Rector for Cultural Activities and Relationships for organizing this, and I'm giving the floor to Matteo Lucrezzi for introducing the speaker. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rector. Thank you, Vice Rector. Thanks to our distinguished speaker, and thanks for all of you for coming here. Today, it's really a pleasure and an honor to welcome our speaker, even because in a way he embodies what we are trying to do here at Foscari in terms of not only interdisciplinary programs, but also the mixture between practitioners and scholars. As some of you may know, actually some of you know because I recognize some of you in the audience, we do have here at Foscari a rather anodyne named Master in Comparative International Relations, which, you know, is a bit shaky in terms when it's translated into English because it's a sort of an odd mixture of comparative government and international relations. But in this particular case, I'm proud to say that the subject of the lecture and, if I may dare to say so, also the biography of the speaker gives rise to an expectation that this is really an apt name, because when we look at the title of the keynote speech today, of this lecture, we do have a mixture of history, international relations, but also urban studies and indeed urban planning and so on and so forth. So this is a way, when it is well done, that we try to achieve at Foscari. So blending sort of our traditional strengths in languages and economics and commerce with sort of the best of area studies around the world. So I'm very keen and look forward to the talk. I'm sure I'm going to have plenty of questions myself, but I will try not to abuse the privilege of a chair, and I will give the students the first chance to sort of ask questions. So please seize it, because otherwise it's going to dive into dialogue. But without any further ado, please let us welcome our guest, and thank you and welcome to Venice.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the very kind introduction. I'm I'm delighted to be here today. It's only my second time visiting Venice. I was last here 20 years ago in 1995 in the middle of the winter when I was working for the UN in Sarajevo. We took a short trip by car driving from Zagreb through Trieste to Venice. So I'm delighted to be back here in Venice and honored to be just speaking to all of you here today. As was just mentioned, I'm here partly as on a tour for my book, which has just been published in Italian. So if any of you are interested, this is my last book. I've got three books. My last book is in English. It's entitled Where China Meets India, Burma, and the New Crossroads of Asia. And it's just been published in Italian. So for those of you who are interested, please do have a look. I'm going to be speaking on a whole range of different topics that I'm going to try to connect as best I can. And in the process, I hope, give you a little bit of a sense of what's happening in Burma or in Myanmar today, but also give you a sense of its history and its possible future, and touch on issues of urban planning, of historical memory, and also the ways in which we're trying to preserve our cultural heritage of the country as well. So a lot of different things, and I hope you'll stay with me, because I think for most people, I would be surprised if many of you in the room have ever been to Burma. Can you raise your hand if anyone's been there? One person, two, three, okay, so a few people. But in general, most haven't, so I'm gonna try to say what I have to say in a way that will be not just of interest, but possible for people who've never been there to follow. So I think the best way to start is always with a map. And so what we have on here is a map of the country. It's a country of 53 million people. It's about the same size, if you want to picture it, of France and Germany combined. From north to south, it's about the same length as the distance from Stockholm to Rome. So it's actually, by European standards, it's quite a reasonably large country. But in Asia, in many ways, it's a very small country, because to one side here we have China, which is much, much bigger and which has 1.3 billion people. And then on the other side, we have India, which is also much, much bigger, and which has over 1 billion people. And the small country next to Bangladesh has over 200 million people, and Thailand and the rest of Southeast Asia on one side. So Myanmar is right in the heart of Asia, and this is something that I will come back to again and again throughout my lecture, throughout my presentation. As some of you will know from reading the newspapers, Myanmar is a very important point in its modern history. We were under a military dictatorship for the last 50 years, from 1962 onwards. The army staged a coup in 1962 and ruled unchecked and without any interruption from 1962 until just a few years ago. In 2011, the army began to release its grip on power. It allowed for elections to take place. It allowed for much greater political freedom than anyone had seen since before 1962. And last November, we held a second set of elections, which was won by the pro-democracy movement, the National League for Democracy, and the leader of that movement that some of you may have heard of, Aung San Suu Kyi, who won the Nobel Prize almost 25 years ago. The constitution that we have is not a democratic constitution, it's a mixed constitution. It's a constitution where the army still has a certain amount of power, it still has seats in parliament, not unlike some other countries, Indonesia in the 1990s, Brazil before its final transition to democracy, it was a hybrid constitution. The army still has a certain amount of power, but there is genuine space, there is genuine political freedom. There's no official censorship anymore, the internet is free, association is much more free, and now this government of Aung San Suu Kyi has taken office just a couple of weeks ago. So we're in the middle of an experiment to see if this transition, which has been organized and carefully planned by the army for quite a long time, is going to be successful, if it's going to be sustainable, if it's going to be something that will lead one day to a full democracy in the normal sense of thinking about it, or if we're going to have a crisis and problems in the months or years ahead. So for a lot of Burmese people who have been waiting for a long time to see the end of military rule, to see a successful economic transition, it's now one of the poorest countries in the world. The next, not just the next few years, but the next few months are absolutely critical in terms of what's going to happen to the 53 million people in the country. And so when people think about Myanmar, people often think about these things, the political transition to democracy, perhaps the development of the country from one of the poorest now in Asia to a more prosperous country. But there's something else as well, which most people from the outside don't fully know, which is that this is also a country that's been under military dictatorship for 50 years, but also has been in civil war with itself for 70 years. Burma or Myanmar is a country that became independent from Britain in 1948, and within 3 months the country was in civil war, first against the Communist Party, which staged an insurrection against the newly independent government, and then against many different ethnic separatist groups that wanted either an independent country of their own or a much more federal system of government with a lot of local autonomy. And so for 70 years, the Burmese army has been fighting not just one, not just five, not just 10, but at least 20 different insurgencies and hundreds of different militia. Today, all along the Chinese-Burmese border in the northeast of the country, and to some extent along the long eastern border with Thailand as well. There are a few others to the west, but the most important ones are to the east. So in addition to the transition to democracy, in addition to the economic reforms and transitions that people are trying to have take place, we also have now, over these few years, this attempt at a peace process in the country to try to end 70 years of armed conflict. And we can talk more about these things if you want during the dialogue and the discussion. But I want to go into a much more important transition as I see it, which is not those three things that are in the news, it's something very different. Which is that in 1962, the army took over, as I mentioned. And if you go back in your mind to 1962, it was the height of the Cold War. President Kennedy was president of the United States. Nikita Khrushchev was premier in the Soviet Union. This was at a time when there were many military dictatorships taking hold in Asia, in Pakistan, in South Korea, in Indonesia a few years later, in Thailand a few years later. So in a way, an army government taking power in Burma was not a very strange thing. And no one really complained internationally. What was very, very strange was that from 1962 to 1964, that army dictatorship decided to completely isolate the country from the rest of the world. Almost all or all foreign companies were kicked out of the country. All foreign aid programs were terminated. Tourists for many years were not allowed to come into the country except for a 24-hour transit visa. In those days, there was no television in Myanmar. Very few people could listen to the BBC internationally. So this was a country that completely closed itself off from the modern world and from the 1960s. And in the 1990s, the army decided that the country should come out of that or begin to come out of that isolation. But at that very same time, Western governments, led by the Americans and by the British, decided to impose sanctions on the country because it felt that it needed to improve its human rights record and move towards democracy. So for the last 20 years, until 2012, we've been under Western sanctions. So we went from 25 years of self-imposed military isolation to 20 years of Western-imposed sanctions. And except for North Korea, no other country in Asia has become or has been so isolated. So I would argue that actually the most important transition that's happening in Myanmar is not so much the transition to democracy, which is incredibly important, the transition to economic prosperity, the transition from war to peace, but this much more general transition from a very isolated country to a country that now in a way desperately wants to rejoin the rest of the world. But there's a problem in this, because on the one hand, if you go to Burma or Myanmar today, what you'll find is that people are incredibly eager, and in some ways almost desperate to be part of the world community, especially young people. People were sick of the isolation and the isolationist policies of the military government in the 60s and 70s. Many people disagreed with Western sanctions in the 1990s and 2000s. And people are very eager to reconnect and take in what's possible. Foreign companies are coming in, hundreds of thousands of tourists are coming into the country, including many from Italy, but also from many other Western countries. And everything that comes in from the outside is eagerly taken in, whether it's new music from the West or from Korea or from Japan, whether it's clothing styles and fashion. People have shifted, especially young people have shifted a lot from wearing traditional Burmese clothes to Western clothes, even in the last two or 3 years. People are very eager to watch whatever they can on TV or see whatever they can on the internet. And everything, you know, for instance, 2 years ago, I think we had the first Western fast food chain, Kentucky Fried Chicken, come into the country. And even the arrival of Kentucky Fried Chicken was welcomed as a big new development because it seemed to mark the country coming back into the global mainstream. But then there's a dark side as well. And the dark side has a history, which is that, you know, the military's decision in 1962 to close off the country just didn't come from anywhere. It came from a very, very strong nationalist tradition, that was ultra-nationalist tradition, that was also a very nativist movement that saw the outside world as something very threatening. And there was a xenophobic element to Burmese culture that had grown up over many decades. What the army did in the 1960s in closing off the country was extreme, but in a way it was the extreme side of a much broader nationalist and nativist set of feelings that had grown up over the 20th century. And so for many, many decades before that, from the 1920s onwards, there were many people who had been talking about the evils of the outside world and how Burma was being threatened by the outside world. And so one thing I want to talk about a little bit is why that was the case. You know, why was there this anti-global sentiment? Why was there this nativist sentiment, which not only led to this isolation in 1962 and half destroyed the country economically for 50 years, but which is still there in some way, and we can get back to that later on. And the reason for that is this. I mean, this is a country. You can't really tell so much from the map, but you know, in the middle of the country is sort of greenish, and the bottom sort of area is greenish, and those are the lowlands of the country. And those lowlands of the country are where about 90% of the people live. And those areas were, from about 2,000 years ago onward, the site of many different Buddhist kingdoms. By about 1,000 years ago, these areas had been united into a single Buddhist kingdom. A single king, a single monarch over a few different dynasties ruled this area from about 1,000 years ago until 1885. In 1885, what happened was that the British had invaded the country many times, and in 1885 they annexed the entire country. They annexed it to the British Indian Empire and destroyed the monarchy, destroyed the aristocracy, destroyed all the old institutions of government, destroyed all the entire elite class that had ruled all of these different towns in those green areas, in the valley and the lowlands for centuries, and replaced it with a new bureaucracy that they imported from British India. And this was a deep shock. You can imagine any country, at least before an occupation, is a deep shock. But it was such a radical social change, a complete uprooting of the organic institutions, if you want to call it that, that had grown up in the country over really 2,000 years, suddenly completely destroyed, almost literally overnight, and in a very, very violent way. Tens of thousands of people died in those years when British rule was first imposed. And a second thing happened in those early years in British rule, which is because the country was part of India, was made part of India, millions of people from India came into the country. And this is a country which has a population then, in say 1910, 1920, of about 10 to 12 million people. And it was receiving 1 million, 2 million people from India every single year as migrant workers, some went home eventually, some stayed on. And so this was a deep shock. You can imagine in a village where people were used to a certain way of life, foreigners came in, British soldiers came in, new bureaucrats came in, a lot of foreigners came in to take up all the modern occupations in the economy, from workers and factories to doctors and professionals. And modern politics in Burma was born 100 years ago in 1915. Inspired by Irish nationalism, the Easter Rising, inspired by the Bolshevik revolution later on, inspired by the rise of Japan in the 1900s and 1910s. And from the very beginning, it was, in a way, an anti-immigrant movement and an anti, what we would call today, global. these were Burmese middle-class lawyers, barristers, ex-civil servants who spoke English, but who looked at what was happening in the country, and what they saw was very rapid economic progress. But what they also saw was a society in which the native Burmese people were at the bottom of the social pyramid that was being created. And so the language of politics in Yangon, which was the capital city, or Rangoon, which was the capital city, was from the very start this kind of, not so much xenophobic in the beginning, but a very nationalist, almost ultra-nationalist sort of movement that saw the Burmese as different from not just the rest of the world, but many other people who would come into Burma over the past few decades. In the 1920s and 1930s, Rangoon became the site of this increasing nationalist rhetoric that looked both to the ultra-right, especially to militaristic Japan in the 1930s, and also to the ultra-left, to the Soviet Union, to the communists, for inspiration politically. But at its core was this nativist, ultra-nationalist sentiment that was there. And what we've had over the past 50, 60 years is really the net result of that feeling, that movement, that political mobilization that first took place in the 1920s and 1930s. In 1941, 1942, the Japanese invaded the country, the British left, the British came back a little bit after World War II, they only stayed about 3 years. And who took their place in this vacuum were these nationalists that had been gaining influence and popularity in the 1930s, the young militant students who had sided with the Japanese during World War II, they created the Burmese army that then became very powerful after independence. And so from that nationalist, ultra-nationalist tradition, you had the foundations of modern Burmese politics after independence, and also the core of the Burmese army in the 1950s that then took over in 1962 and isolated the country completely. And the problem is this. If you go back to what I was saying before, we're at this moment, this tipping point in the country's history in terms of democracy, in terms of economic change, in terms of the peace process. And in a way, I think people in Burma or Myanmar today have this desire to rejoin the rest of the world, have the desire to create a new liberal consensus that will incorporate ethnic minorities in the country, that will allow the country to kind of break free of its past to some extent. At the same time, you have a history that is being taught in Rangoon and in other cities that's making it harder in some ways for people to move in that direction. Because the only history that's taught in schools and universities in the country is this history of the nationalist movement. The only history that is taught in schools and universities is that the British came, they were very evil, they destroyed the country, then the nationalists came, they kicked out the British. No one mentions World War II and 1 million British and Japanese and Americans fighting, but that the army came, they kicked out the British, and then they're now there to unite the country. And so people have this instinct that they want something more free and more liberal and more engaged with the rest of the world and more cosmopolitan in a way. But the perception of history is something that pulls people back in a slightly different direction. And I think the fear, my fear in a way, is that as the country opens up, as the poorest and the weakest country in the region, companies will come in, foreigners will come in, people will want to pull Burma back into the rest of the world, then it's going to be very easy for this nationalist, ultra-nationalist, nativist sentiment to come back. Because all that people have been taught is how important and how positive that was in the 20th century. And what I want to give you a sense of, and what I hope, what I've tried to give people a sense of in Rangoon, in Yangon, and in Myanmar over the past few years, through some of the work and the writing that I've done and the speaking that I've done, is that in Rangoon and in Burma, there is also a very different tradition, something that's very, very different from what is taught in the history books and what is at the core of the Burmese nationalist tradition so far. And it's a past, and long past, that has always been much more globally engaged, that it is a past that has always been much more connected to the rest of the world, a past and a past of a city that has been much more cosmopolitan than anyone would think about if all they knew was what they read in the school textbooks, in the high school textbooks in the country. If we go a long way back, in 127 BC, the Chinese explorer, a Chinese explorer from Xi'an, which is to the far, maybe about 2,000 kilometers to the north and slightly to the east of Burma, was trying to find a way to the west. And at that time, there was no connection between China and the west, or no known connection between China and the west. And he went, it took him about 15 years to get to what is now Afghanistan and then back. They were trying to find allies against the Turkish Confederacy that was then in the, just to the north of China. What he learned when he was in Afghanistan was that there was another route from the southwest across India through what is now Burma to China. And this is how the Chinese discovered Burma, because they realized from that long trip to Afghanistan that there was this other people, this other land to their southwest that somehow connected to the sea and to India. 200 years later, in 124 AD, an embassy from the west arrived at what is now the China-Burma border. And we don't know exactly where that embassy comes from. The Chinese were very interested in that embassy because it included about 30 entertainers, jugglers, and acrobats, and musicians. And when the Chinese interviewed them, and we have the accounts of this interview, when the Chinese interviewed them, they said they were Roman subjects. And we don't know where in the Roman Empire they came from, probably from Antioch, from Alexandria, somewhere in the Eastern Mediterranean. But that was also at a time when Burma had become this link or this very initial crossroads between East and West. For a lot of the remaining history of the country in the next 2,000 years or 1,900 years, Burma was never really a major highway globally. Because as I think you all know, being here in Venice, between Venice and Malacca, and then to the east, the highways were mostly maritime routes or land routes on the old Silk Road across Central Asia. And Burma was this kind of missing link that was never really used as a highway. But from a Burmese perspective, Burma was a place where, if you look at our long history, it really reached its fullest potential. You go to Burma and you can go to the medieval ruins in Pagan, you can look at many other cities in the north, as well as cities around old towns and cities around Rangoon. It really reached its fullest potential when it was much more engaged with the rest of the world. And there were periods where Burma was very engaged. Our height, sort of not in ancient times, but in medieval times, was in the 11th, 12th, 13th century. Burma was very much engaged with the Indian world, where there was a lot of importation of religious ideas and other ideas. The alphabet, Burmese language, was reduced to writing about 1000 AD. So our civilization really flourished when it was much more connected to the rest of the world, and always declined in periods of isolation from global trends and what was going on in the rest of the world. As some of you may know, but I think most of you don't, the first European who ever arrived in Burma was from Venice, Niccolo de Conti, who arrived in 1420-something. And he was then traveling all around, and he came to Burma, and he actually came to exactly where Rangoon is today. Two more Venetians came, an Englishman came in the 1500s, and these were the earliest contacts with Europe. But it wasn't until really the 1700s that what is today Rangoon became a city and became a center. You all know the 7 Years' War between the British and the French. We all know the different theaters of that war in Quebec, in India, and elsewhere. Very few people know that Burma was actually a theater of that war as well. We were in a civil war between the north of the country and the south. The French sided with the south, the English sided with the north. The north won, the French side lost. And there's actually a legacy of this, which is very interesting. Just as the French side lost in what is now Rangoon, a French ship with 300 people was arriving in Rangoon. The winning side from the north, which founded the last dynasty, captured that ship, took the 300 Frenchmen, who were all from Normandy and from Brittany, and they marched them north to what is now near Mandalay, to villages just north of Mandalay. And their descendants are still there today. And it was then that that new king, who had just banished these 300 Frenchmen, decided to create this new city of Rangoon. And so Rangoon was founded as a victory city for the side that had won in our civil war as part of the Seven Years' War. But it was also founded as a port, and it was founded as the country's window on the world. And this was a dynasty in the 1770s, 1780s that really wanted to join the rest of the world. Burma was a major exporter of teak for European shipbuilding. Burma was also very connected northwards to trade with China as well. But the real modern history of the city and the creation of a very cosmopolitan city goes back to the British times. The English invaded the country first in 1824. They took over Rangoon in 1853. And from the start, they wanted to make Rangoon a great entrepot, a great trading center. And Rangoon grew from a relatively small town of about 20,000-30,000 to 300,000 or 400,000 by about 1910-1915. It was a very advanced country for its time, the first electric trams, the first movie cinemas, the first telegraphs in the region were in Rangoon. You could fly in those days directly from London, you could fly out to Melbourne. Rangoon was a city that was connected in many different ways with the rest of the world. It was a place where many big British companies had their headquarters and their homes. Oil is one of the biggest, oldest industries in Burma, and Burma actually has one of the oldest oil industries anywhere in the world. And when the English took over, they created a company called Burma Oil. And Burma Oil, about 1910, decided to explore for oil in what is now Iran. They discovered oil there, and they created a new company, Anglo-Persian Oil, which is now British Petroleum. And so there are a number of different big businesses that actually started in Burma at the time. And this is at a time when Rangoon was a city of people from all over the world. You have a long-standing Armenian community in Burma. You have a long-standing Gujarati Muslim community. People came from all across India, from all across China. Jews from Baghdad immigrated to Burma, to Rangoon in the 1800s. At one point, just before World War II, Rangoon was 2% Jewish, with a Jewish mayor, two Jewish synagogues and many Jewish schools. Rangoon was a city where people from Scotland and England, but also many other countries in Europe, there was a big German population at the time. It became 60% people from different parts of South Asia, from the north near Afghanistan all the way to the south. And of course it was a place of where people visited from everywhere as well, from the great writers from Kipling to Somerset Maugham to Noel Coward to Ernest Hemingway, all came and spent some time and wrote about their times in Rangoon. We live in a building that was built in 1927, that was the home of Pablo Neruda, the great Chilean poet in the late 1920s. And so it was a country that connected in so many different directions and for different times, it was home to different people. But all of these things are things that are not talked about, that are not discussed, that are not taught anywhere in the Burmese schools. And so this broader cosmopolitan tradition, this broader past of how Burma and Burmese civilizations, even Rangoon as a city, has in the past flourished and prospered as a connected place, as a global city in many ways, is something that is not known to Burmese people. And for me, I came back to Rangoon 4 years ago. I was working, as I mentioned earlier, I was working in the UN for many years, in Cambodia, in the former Yugoslavia, in New York, and I taught history at Cambridge for a few years. And I came back, first I moved to Bangkok in 2007 and became involved in issues related to the reform process in Burma, looking at ways in which to try to push for change in the country. And when change finally did come in 2011, I accidentally became involved in conservation and urban planning. It's not my background, I'm not an architect, I'm not an urban planner, I never thought that I would be involved in this issue. And for me it was a purely aesthetic thing. I don't have a photograph, I'm sorry, of Rangoon today, but downtown Rangoon is a place of about 800 or 900 late 19th century, early 20th century buildings that are left. Over 1,000 have been destroyed in the past 20 years, between 1991 and 2011. And I saw these beautiful old buildings being destroyed one by one, and they were coming closer and closer to the core of the old downtown, and all I really wanted was to see the demolition stopped. I talked to some some of the army generals at the time to see if this could be stopped. And I took advantage of the reform process beginning in 2011 to try to convince some of the government ministers that there was value in keeping these buildings. And nobody understood that, because that history hadn't been taught. The cosmopolitan past wasn't known, appreciated, or valued. The history of these buildings was not. All they saw were old buildings that were sort of crumbling and not in a very good state. And so I had to make the argument that, well, it's worth money because tourists will come, and you know, all these other cities in Europe like Venice, they make billions of dollars from the tourist trade, so you should keep these buildings because even if you don't like them, foreigners will like them and they will come. So that was the only argument that I could make. But after a while, after 6 months or so, I set up what is called the Youngblood Heritage Trust. You can go online, you can go to our website, it's now an organization of about 30 people. And what we tried to do was first this advocacy with government to try to say whatever we had to say to stop the demolition. And in that, we've been successful. 1,000 buildings were destroyed between 1991 and 2011, but maybe only about 10 or 20 since 2011. So we've been, and none of them really are public buildings. So we've been successful at halting the demolition. I think if we hadn't done what we had done, most of what's left in downtown Rangoon would be gone. So we did what we did, we had to do, we said what we had to say with government to make that point. But then we wanted to make this broader point, a more genuine point, which is that this is a downtown that's not just a bunch of old English buildings, but that's really important for our history. And to make these broader points about the history and memory of downtown, trying to recover the memory of downtown, we tried to argue that this was an area where the nationalist movement was born, better or for worse, and this was the area where all of Burma's greatest statesmen, writers, artists lived and worked for many, many decades. It's where so much of modern Burmese culture was born, whether it's music influenced by jazz or by other music from India, whether it was modern Burmese cuisine, even modern Burmese dress that people see as traditional, was actually something that grew up in that urban landscape in the late 19th century. We've tried to show people that, you know, you look at these old buildings and behind each building, there's a whole history to be told, and people have no idea. And people had no idea about the communities that used to live there, whether the Armenians or the Jews or the Sarathis or others. And we've been extremely successful at, you know, even just giving tours. Our tours, when we advertise them online, they fill up within 2 or 3 minutes. We've had thousands of young Burmese people now go on these tours with us around the city to show them what the history of the city is all about. And in a way, that's been the easy part. We've also tried to do a lot of public outreach. We did a program just 6 months ago where we gave a lot of young people aged 7 to 70 Polaroid cameras to photograph downtown what they thought was valuable in their own communities and in their own neighborhoods. So we've tried to engage with the communities that are living in downtown. There's a lot of oral history that still needs to be properly recorded and archived and reflected on as well. But that's the easy part. The hard part is that you have this city in Rangoon with 5 million people. If our economic growth strategies are successful, it will go up to, Burma will urbanize, it will go from 20% to maybe 30% to 35% urban. Cities will grow, Rangoon may go from 5 to 7 to 8 million people in 10 or 15 years. And as everyone knows from modern developing country cities, from Lagos to Lagos to Jakarta, cities can be a big problem. Cities are a place of possible social tension, possible violence, possible crime, but also cities are just very difficult to govern. And in Rangoon, the huge issues are just having sufficient electricity, terrible traffic jams that have developed over the years, just the past few years, problems of basic infrastructure, health, housing, affordable housing for the many poor people. And so how do you slot in this issue of conservation and memory? And I've not tried to argue that this is the most important thing, but what I've tried to argue is that, first of all, we're not talking about the entire city. That, you know, what the old city that we have in Rangoon is really only about 10% of the modern city. There's a lot of room for development that should be properly planned. But I try to argue that even though for many people this is not the most important thing, trying to, you know, in 10 or 15 years, when we become a more developed country, hopefully, when we become a medium income country, when the city is that much more prosperous, people will almost certainly regret having torn down their history at that point. If you look at the trajectory of many other cities in the region, Jakarta, Manila, Bangkok, many people regret the demolitions, the destruction of their old urban fabric that took place 20 or 30 years ago. I've tried to argue that in our country right now, the most important thing is low-skilled, low-income, low-cost manufacturing and industrialization to create millions of jobs that are necessary to get the economy off the ground, repeating the experiences of many Asian countries. But hopefully in 15 years or so, when we reach the level of, say, Thailand today, there'll be a need to really try to attract all kinds of talent, develop creative industries, create more knowledge-based industries, and at that time, having a beautiful old city in the middle of Rangoon will be something that economically will be worth billions of dollars. But even more important than that is that at this time of transition in our country, when we have to think about the past and think about the future, when we have to have, I think, a new appreciation of the cosmopolitan nature of our past to try to combat the worst aspects of the nationalism that has taken us in this certain direction over the past 50 years, having this physical link also to that past, that cosmopolitan past, the buildings where different people had lived, the enormous diversity of places of worship in downtown Rangoon is also going to be incredibly important as well. So to conclude, I mean, this is, if you read about Burma in the newspapers over the coming years, I think what you have to, or coming weeks and months, I think what you have to think about is this is really a country that sounds like a fairy tale story of an evil military dictatorship and a good democracy movement. But there are many, many layers of complexity that often are not discussed. This is a country where it's at a tipping point in so many different ways. It's a place where the Chinese want to finish their 2,000-year-old dream of connecting across Burma to the sea. This is a country where India also wants to counter Chinese influence, but also has its ambitions of connecting across Burma, not so much to China, but down to Southeast Asia. This is a country where the countries of Southeast Asia, like Vietnam and Thailand, want to connect across Burma to China and especially to South Asia. This is a country that has tremendous potential as a geographic center and crossroads of Asia, but it will only be able to fulfill that potential if it overcomes this nationalism, this narrow nationalism that has animated so much of world politics. So when you look at stories about Burma or Rangoon in the newspapers over the coming months and years, think about that and the signals for whether or not, where that debate is moving and whether or not Burma is moving closer to being confident in opening up to the outside world, or whether it's slipping back into the kinds of nationalism that we've seen over the past 50 years. Thank you very much.
Go ahead. But thank you so much for this absolutely lively lecture. I'm certainly sold on the book. I don't know about you, but I mean, I for one pretty much look forward to sort of like buying and reading it. And like the lecture was indeed fascinating and lent itself to quite a few questions. I do have a long list of questions myself here, which I don't want to start with because I want to give like a chance to all of you to get your digs in. Because I mean, as a professor of international relations and as someone who was setting up a international crisis group field office in Northeast Asia, I mean, a lot of things here resonated with me, but I don't want to, as I said, abuse my privilege as a chair, so I would like really to open it up, but I'm going to give you a very short sort of like window of time for you to raise your hand, and otherwise I'm going to dig in with my own questions. And, so come on, don't be shy, go ahead.
Hello.
Well, there is going to be a mic coming. So.
Okay.
If you can tell us who you are.
Okay. I'm Kate Allison, and I'm Australian, but I lived in Cambodia for 3 years working for an international non-governmental organization called that worked with capacity development for local organizations. And my question is, you spoke before about tipping points. And I'm wondering what the enabling environment is for civil society, especially since 2011 in Myanmar, and also whether or not it's more locally driven or externally. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for the question. It's a very good question. In under the military dictatorship from 1962 through the early 2000s, there was very little room for civil society narrowly defined in the sense of NGOs that were formal and working. I mean, there was civil society in the sense that religion was always free, and so there were lots of Buddhist associations, churches, and mosques were allowed to operate freely, and so there were informal networks of people who were engaged in charity work and things, but the formal civil society or NGO sector was extremely small or almost non-existent. That began to change in 2008, when, as you might remember, there was this devastating cyclone that impacted the country. 125,000 people died in over a 24-hour period. So even for a military government that was fairly immune to thinking too much about individual suffering, that this was a shock. And this led both to the military government beginning to allow much more foreign aid to come into the country, relatively speaking, but also to giving more space to the few Burmese NGOs that were beginning to establish themselves. And I mention that because those NGOs in 2008, 9, 10 actually played quite a decisive role in convincing the generals at the time, or some of the generals, that they needed to move the country in a different direction. So the NGOs, the few that were allowed to and able to exist, some of whom received foreign funding for humanitarian work, some of whom were financed locally, played an important role in creating the intellectual environment around which the initial reforms took place in 2011. Since 2011, space is wide open. It's much easier to register as an NGO, and if you don't have registration, you can still operate. It's not criminal to operate without registration. So we have hundreds of NGOs and thousands of local civil society organizations in the village of Thant. There is foreign aid coming to the country. Some of that foreign aid goes through local NGOs. There's a lot of international NGOs that come, but it's nothing like Cambodia in terms of the dependence of the NGO sector on foreign aid. For instance, in my NGO, the Myint Heritage Trust, which is a registered Myanmar NGO, which just got a registration a few months ago, most of our funding, I would say about 80% of our funding is local, that we raise through dinners from local businessmen, from local contributions. Only a little bit is from some foreign sources, foundations, family foundations outside. So there is a big NGO sector. And I guess, in a more detailed analysis, you could look at different trends depending on the sector and things. But in general, it's a big NGO sector, and whether it becomes very influenced by foreign aid and the politics around the foreign aid, I think it will depend on what happens next, because aid levels are increasing very fast in the country as well.
Any other
focused on this idea of Islam as a threat. But that's very much a should I put it? It's an intellectual discourse within that community. Separate from that is something else, which is that the country is maybe, we don't know, the census figures will come out soon, 5-6% or so. So out of 53 million people, it means about a million or more. Is that right? 5%. 5%. So 10% would be 2.5 million. 2.5 million more. 2.5-3 million or so in the country. Almost all in urban areas. And so in many cities like where we live in Rangoon, it's about 40% Muslim downtown. So many towns are 20%. And those Muslims are almost all, there's a Chinese Muslim community, but they're generally almost all people of South Asian descent coming from what is today India and Pakistan. There is a history of prejudice. There is a history going back to the 1930s of communal violence that has taken place a couple of times. There's a history of tensions in those urban communities, but there's also a very long history of friendship and people going to school together, people working together and buying from each other's shops and living alongside each other. And I'm pretty confident that in those places, and with those Muslim communities, you know, in our neighborhood, for instance, they are the shopkeepers, they are businessmen, the biggest construction companies in Rangoon are owned by prominent Muslim businessmen. So in those areas, there's also a lot of reason to be hopeful and a lot of reason to think that the violence that we saw 2 years ago in the center of the country was politically manipulated. That if it wasn't for that political manipulation, if the government had a very strong signal that anyone trying to foment communal unrest would be dealt with very harshly under the law, then there's a lot of reason to think that that would improve. And there's a lot of reasons to think that this new government will try to be more inclusive towards those long-standing Muslim communities, mainly of many of Indian descent. That's different again from the Rohingya situation in the far west of the country, but in the far west of the country, right on the Bangladesh border. That is a very specific community of people. You have that area of the country, it's a state called Rakhine State now, used to be the Kingdom of Arakan, which was independent until 1785, then the Burmese came in and the British came 20 years later. So it was almost never under Burmese rule. It was under their own kingdom and then it was under the British. They are a Buddhist people, but they are a minority within the country. There are 4 million of them, the Arakanese. And they believe that they are the victims of discrimination. Their narrative or their self, their sort of what they say to themselves and what they say to others as well, people will listen, is that they are a once proud kingdom that have come under the Burmese, that have come under this Burmese military rule, and that the Burmese military rulers have been deliberately trying to destroy their identity and destroy their country. And that they have gone from being 80-90% of their country to being about 40%. And that Burmese coming from the rest of the country are now 30%. And they believe that that Muslim community there, which is about 30%, are people who've immigrated from what is today Bangladesh over the last 50 to 100 years. So they see that Rohingya community as being an immigrant community. If you ask them and if you talk to people there, they will say, and both the Rohingya community and the Arakanese Buddhist community are incredibly poor. This is the poorest place in the country. It used to be very rich in British times, and now it's completely cut off from everywhere. It's very, very poor. They believe, if you talk to them, they will say that, okay, the ones who came during British times, whose grandfathers, great-grandfathers came in British times, they can stay. But they genuinely believe that many of this Rohingya community are actually people who came illegally over the last 10, 20 years. If you talk to the UN and you talk to Western embassies, very few people believe that that is the case. They believe that 90% are actually people who were born there and whose ancestors were born there. But the Arakanese Buddhists, they believe that a big number are illegal immigrants that the military regime deliberately allowed to come in to try to destroy their identity. The situation, we had the violence in 2012. A couple of hundred people were killed, about two-thirds on the Muslim side, one-third on the Buddhist side. 100,000 Rohingya Muslims were displaced from their homes. 100,000 are in IDP camps. There has been some improvement in the sense that, you know, if you went to that area in 2013, it was on a boil. Any little incident, one person punching somebody else, would have led to a lot of violence. we've gone from that situation to a situation, because of a lot of dialogue facilitated by NGOs, by government and others, to a situation which is much, much more calmer, and we've seen no violence since then. The big problem is you have 100,000 people who cannot go home that are in these camps. In the last 6 months, about 25,000 of those people have been quietly resettled back into their homes. So there's minimal, small progress. The problem for this new government is that they only have a certain amount of political capital. They are still trying to figure out how much space the army is going to give them, if they're going to be people who are looking out to kind of try to trip them up in some way. This issue, this Muslim issue, is something that's super sensitive. Even the word Rohingya is incredibly sensitive to use in the country. And so whether or not they try to tackle that head on as an initial issue, or whether they put it on the back burner, at least take a zero violence approach, but still not really put much energy to it until 1 or 2 years later.
Well, I will ask a question just because it's burning, and I think it's actually relevant for everybody here. I mean, as a professor of international relations, you mentioned the role of sanctions in isolating the military regime. And my question is really aimed at understanding what was the reaction of the opposition? Did the opposition ask for these sanctions from the international community? Did they play a role? Did they harm? Did they delay the transition? Because, I mean, we do have, I mean, as President of the United States Association, this is something that is debated all the time when it comes to Iran, when it comes to before that to Libya, and countries that are subject to some sanctions. So, I mean, it's for me a unique occasion to get a perspective from Burma and to see what role the sanction played there.
Yeah, two quick answers first. One is that I believe completely that sanctions played a negative role and held back political change for 20 years. And yes, many in the opposition demanded sanctions. And I know this because I used to myself. And I remember back in 1991, we had just had this big uprising against the army. Hundreds of people were killed when I was crushed. And so many people were so angry that we wanted anything that would show a hard line against the military regime. And so I spent months in Washington and London trying to campaign for sanctions. And I changed my mind in 1992, 1993. Because I felt that as the army regime was trying to open up the country after such a long period of isolation, we should actually use that opportunity to push rather than to push them back into that isolation. That a less isolated landscape was one in which liberal political change was more likely than a closed landscape. This constitution, as I mentioned, is a hybrid constitution. It's not a democratic constitution. It's actually the same, more or less, the same constitution the army first proposed in 1995. In 1995, the army, through this manipulated political convention, wanted something like what we have now. But the response from the opposition and the response from the Americans, for example, was, it's not good enough, it's not the democracy we want, and we will not accept it. And so we went through this long period, about 10 years, of trying to negotiate, mediate, the UN was involved, nothing happened, politics were frozen. It's only when actually the military from a position of strength felt we're in charge of the country, we're not going to deal with the Americans or anybody else, we're going to put in place this new constitution, that things began to move in a certain direction.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, Daniele Sferra. I had the privilege to be in your country for 2 months as long-term observer of the European Union. The European Union has been invited for the first time to observe last elections. I was deployed in Champ North State, and it was a quite sensitive area because it was an area that was affected by ethnic armed conflicts. My question is regarding now the future of the country. Since this election, 25% of the members of the parliament have been directly elected by the military. And of course, I mean, on the country is facing new economical challenges, new internationalization, but how can this cope with this legal framework of the country, constitutional framework, where still the military have this 25%, and even the country cannot undergo any constitutional changes since it needs 75% plus 1%. And my also second question is regarding the ceasefire conflict, ceasefire agreement of the ethnic army groups, how this will be in the future. Thank you.
Okay, two big questions. It's one. One is on the constitution. I mean, it's not just the case that the army has 25% of seats in parliament. The army is still the central, most important institution in the country, anywhere you look at. I mean, the thing is, it's not as if we had a grassroots revolution that forced change, and the army is still hanging on to some power. It's that the army, from a position of confidence, decided to try to take a step back and see what happens. And so the army still has the ultimate power in the country. The army, through this constitution, has created a box within which it's going to allow this multi-party system to handle day-to-day government, especially on economic issues. And I think the thing that will convince the army to take a further step back and look at reducing its formal role in politics, in parliament, and everything else is two things. One is, if this new government, or any new government that's not a civilian government, does well in terms of the economic management of the country, and they genuinely want to see, I think, economic development and prosperity. And two, it's the armed conflict that you mentioned as well. If that subsides and the country is at peace, I think this new generation of generals very much wants to be, they want to have a modern army that guards the borders and guards the country and not be involved in counterinsurgency for another generation or two. So I guess the answer to the first question, my answer to the first question is, it's going to take time. I think if my feeling is that if the opposition, if the government now, the National League for Democracy and Civil Society, would push for constitutional change now, they will enter into quite a direct confrontation with the army very quickly. At a time when they have for the first time been given genuine authority over health, education, finance, and economic development issues. If they wait 2-3 years, show a good record of governance, then maybe it would be possible. I'm not suggesting to be a wait of 10, 20 years. A few years may be necessary to get the military more comfortable with the current arrangement and look for additional changes. From the National League for Democracy's point of view, I think this arrangement is acceptable only because it's a first step towards the democracy they want. For the army, this is the setup that they have been waiting 20 years to establish. So they have a very different perspective on where we are in a way. And I'm not sure they're in a rush to change it. I think in terms of the ceasefires, as I mentioned, that we not only have roughly 20 different armed groups. The biggest has over 25,000 troops, one of the biggest non-state armies in the world, very well armed with surface-to-air missiles, their own airport, helicopters, everything else, heavy artillery, and maybe by some count, 900 to 1,000 militia groups in the Shan state and all along the eastern border. I've been involved in the peace process since 2011. There was an attempt to negotiate a nationwide ceasefire pact. In the end, the document was agreed by almost all of the major armed groups, except for that biggest one. But then, in the run-up to the elections, because people were also positioning themselves around this election, only half of the armed groups signed the nationwide. Now the ball is very much in the new government's court. It depends on what their strategy is going to be going forward. The principal demand of these armed groups is a federal system of government, which is not in principle anymore objectionable to anyone. But we're a long ways away, I think, from agreeing and implementing on the exact new constitutional arrangement. The added complicating factor is that China has had a major involvement border. For decades, it armed the communist insurgents there. The army has alleged that the Chinese are still involved in the armed conflict. On this side, the Chinese are very upset because the Burmese have also conducted operations which have been crossed over into the their side of the border as well. So there's an international dimension that's also extremely sensitive and very complicated. So I'd like to say that we're a year or two away, but I think it's also, this is going to be not just a many, many year process, but one where probably we'll see progress in certain parts of the country before others as well.
Good afternoon, I'm Lisa. I'm a student of management here in Kapustri, and I'm doing my thesis about Myanmar. So I'm going to ask you to know your opinion about the future perspective about the respect of human rights here in Myanmar.
The
Sorry,
future of human rights,
yes.
I think that's a big question. I think that it's very unlikely that we will, as I was mentioning before, I think it's not clear at all what the speed of change towards a more democratic system will be, whether it takes 2-3 years or 10-20 years. But I think it's very unlikely that the country will go back to pure military dictatorship, or will go back to a very closed system, or that we will lose the kinds of political freedoms that we've had the last few years. Basically, we have this hybrid constitution, but we have a much more liberal, free political situation. And so I think in terms of basic freedom of speech, of association, I think these things are much, much better than 5 years ago, and I think that will likely stay. I mean, there'll be problems, but certainly no more than in many other countries in the region. I think there have been major improvements in terms of labor rights, with new labor unions and rights of workers to unionize. I think in terms of ethnic issues, in terms of non-discrimination, I think that's going to be a difficult process going forward, but I think that's something that, even if you leave the peace process to one side, I think the government can move quite quickly on if it wants to. I think on the whole range of economic and social rights, the biggest problem for that and also for development generally is that, you know, it's quite clear what needs to happen in the country. This is a very rich country, it's rich in natural resources, it needs to do what so many countries in the region have done. It can see explosive growth that will lift living standards within half a generation. But the institutions are so weak that's going to be great. And the institutions to regulate, to monitor, to enforce human rights standards, it's incredible. The judicial system is in tatters, it's incredibly corrupt. And to undo and change all these institutions, it's actually easier to create new institutions. It's actually reforming these old structures. That's going to be, at best, a generational challenge.
All right. I think on this hopeful note, sadly, this is my way ahead of most women studies. So I want to you to join me in thanking the speaker and for this exceptional lecture. And I thank all of you thank all of you for coming here. I think there is a world private vice rector.
I too would like, on behalf of Professor Bouliez, the rector of Canopy, to leave for other engagements. I would like to thank wholeheartedly Dr. Thant for his lecture and for being so kind as to answer all the questions which came from the floor. I think it's the first time you have so many questions from the floor. I'm very, very much pleased about it. But I think that depends entirely on our distinguished guest's lecture and all the ideas that he gave us. And opening up also our mind towards this country, which of course we know, but we don't know enough. And I'm pretty sure that all of us are far, far richer than we have been a few hours ago. So thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.